Good morning.
My
name is Jacob Bastomski. I'm a chiropractor here in Santa Barbara. I've been in practice in Santa Barbara for about 32 years, and about half of my practice, besides chiropractic, it involves nutritional medicine, functional medicine we call it, and today's lecture will be all about functional medicine. We will cover, to start with, I'm going to talk about the different models of treatment. And then we will get into the functional medicine model of treatment. There's five factors that are very important that we will talk about. Altogether, I have a half hour with you folks, so we're going to cover a lot of territory in a half hour. And I'll ask that you hold the questions till the end so we can get through all the material, please. To begin with, from a holistic perspective, you could say there are three things that we look at when we are asking a question: what causes disease? Think of a triangle. I'm a chiropractor, and so at the base of the triangle, we talk about structure. Structure means that if your spine is properly lined up, your nerve energy is flowing well, and that aspect of your health is handled. Chiropractic is all about balancing the spine so that your nerve energy from the brain down the cord to the body works well, and from the body back up the cord to the brain works well. That flow of energy, that's structure. If the structure is off, like after a whiplash injury or after a trauma, then it can impact the nervous system. The next part to the triangle deals with the emotional aspect of health. Emotions are huge, and clearly, they're one of the biggest factors of why people will have dysfunction and disease impacting them down the road or even immediately. A patient of mine is a psychologist, and she had mentioned the other day that it was interesting that after a person has been violated with a rape or sexual battery and such, inevitably she finds that a year or two later there are all kinds of digestive and food allergy type problems coming their way. So that's the second aspect of it. The third part of it is what we're going to be talking about today, and that's about physiology. That's about the chemistry within the body. And today we're going to talk about all the things that impact the chemistry in the body and the physiology. So to start with, then, we're going to look at blood sugar. We're going to talk quite a bit in the beginning about blood sugar. Next, we're going to hit the digestive system. Within the digestive system, there's aspects of what's called good and bad microbes. And so when our internal environment is amiss, is dysfunctional, then we invite a lot of bad microbes more into our system. And when the environment internally is healthy, then the better microbes are the ones that are dominant. In a general statement, approximately 85% of the microbes in our body should be healthy, and 15% can be problematic kinds. And the 85 keep the 15% in check. We're going to talk more about that later as we hit the digestive level. Then we're going to talk about food allergies and sensitivities and their impact on health. Then we're going to talk about toxic chemicals and metals that are out there in the environment and that impact us. And it's all about if your liver is working well, because it is, and it can handle these toxic chemicals. And if it's not, if it's congestant, then these toxic chemicals and metals are going to impact our physiology. And last, we're going to talk about hormones, things like thyroid and adrenal, estrogen, testosterone. Some of the common conditions that respond very nicely to a functional medical model is obesity, chronic fatigue, depression, insomnia, irritable bowel, digestive problems, chronic pain, autoimmune disorders like lupus, Crohn's disease, rheumatoid arthritis, Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Hashimoto's thyroiditis, by the way, is the most common autoimmune disease out there. And type 2 diabetes, otherwise known as adult onset diabetes. Although these days, I had a kid just the other day, he's probably 19 years old and has already been put on diabetic medication as if though he were 55 or 65 years old. Different models of treatment, I want to talk about that a little bit more. So I'm presenting a model today that's holistically based. It's called functional medicine. Dr. Oz, probably about a month ago, had on his show about five physicians, and he said, these physicians, I believe, are the best out there. If any member of my family needed to go to a physician, I would recommend that they would see these five physicians. And what they have in common, he said, is that they practice a new model of medicine called functional medicine. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. in more detail. So what's the medical model of treatment, for example? The medical model of treatment is diagnose the condition like hypertension, like high cholesterol, sleep disorder, depression, diagnose the condition, and then give a medication for that condition. So if you have high blood pressure, you take a blood pressure pill. If you have cholesterol, you take a cholesterol pill. If you're not sleeping well, you take a sleeping medication. If you have a mood disorder, you take a depression medication, etc. And so stomach problems and something that blocks acid. It's actually fairly simplistic in its approach in that it's not really dealing with some of the underlying issues right over here that are setting the stage for why these diseases are popping up. As I said earlier, another model might be a person, let's say, has depression or has digestive disorders and can't sleep well. Very common to see that. And so they'll go to the psychologist, and the psychologist will say, yeah, sure, I know what it is. And so they'll recommend talk therapy. They'll go to a nutritionist. The nutritionist says, we can do nutrition therapy. Or you go to an acupuncturist, says, yeah, acupuncture is going to help that. So everyone sees the world through their own glasses in terms of their model that they're preaching, in terms of what's going to impact that patient's health. We're going to talk about a functional medicine model. Here we go. Now, this over here is reality, and all it says is that the cost of healthcare is going up tremendously, and the cost of wages is not at all keeping up with the cost of healthcare. I would argue that the model that is primarily being used that's driving the healthcare costs is not a good model, and a better model is the functional medicine model. Now we're going to talk about sugar quite a bit, because sugar is huge. If you have sugar imbalances, there's no way that you're going to stabilize a given condition. You're going to have a very tough time. So this is called the glycemic index of foods. The glycemic index basically means that certain foods, when you ingest them, will have a huge dumping of sugar into the bloodstream, and it will spike the blood sugar. And the more it spikes the blood sugar, the more difficult the body has a hard time dealing with that spike, and it sets off a bunch of problems down the road if that pattern continues. And so this gives you a little bit of a feel for the amount of spiking to the blood sugar that a certain foods do, and that's called the glycemic index. We want to use foods that are low glycemic. We'll talk more about diet shortly. Good carbohydrates versus bad carbohydrates. So a good carbohydrate would be something like broccoli, for example, or vegetables, for example. These are items that will slowly release their sugar into the bloodstream, and then insulin gets kicked in once there's blood sugar that's elevated, and insulin then brings the blood sugar down in a gentle fashion. When you're taking a high glycemic food, you're going to have a spike in your blood sugar, a spike in your insulin, and that's going to drop the blood sugar down quite rapidly. And when it gets down low, that's when people will start feeling irritable, anxious, moody, sleepy, things like that, as a result of that sharper drop in blood sugar. Here we're looking about the amount of additional added refined sugar into the diet that's been going on from 1970 down to current day over there. You'll see in general that there's a total caloric sweeteners has been a rise of that. People are taking in approximately 130, 140 pounds of sugar, refined sugar, in their diet. Most of that these days, since 1970, high fructose corn syrup has come on the scene. A lot of people believe that that is a real problematic item, more so than even refined sugar, although it's somewhat debatable whether it's refined sugar or high fructose corn syrup. They're both problem items because they're very high glycemic. This shows the, from 1700 all the way to current day, it shows the gradual increase of the amount of sugar that's in the diet. And it shows the correlating slide over here, starting early 1900 with the accelerated rate of obesity that is prevalent in society. Direct correlation. And now you also see a correlation relative to higher incidence of diabetes occurring. So when you have, again, high sugar, you're going to end up with high insulin. High insulin is going to start setting off pathways of inflammation. Inflammation is going to set up chronic pain. There's lots of things that increased insulin does. It congests the liver. increases blood pressure, increases your cholesterol. The very interesting study that Dr. Linus Pauling talks about in his book, Live Longer Now, where they took a prison population and they could actually, of course, monitor that diet very, very closely. And they gave them a bunch of sugar foods, and they watched their cholesterol over the next month. Up it went, just with increasing sugar. Then they took the sugar out of the diet. Down it went. So when you see a donut shop, for example, that says no cholesterol, but plenty of sugar, it's really a fiction. More sugar, more cholesterol. It's not just saturated fat. We'll mess with your brain chemistry. Increases oxidative stress, which is free radicals and such. In men, it's going to increase estrogen. In women, it's going to increase testosterone. In women, when they start having more facial hair, that's an indication of sugar problem. In men, when they start having gynecomastia, it's called breast development, that's a sugar problem. Stages leading to diabetes. So first you start with low blood sugar, then you go to insulin resistance. The body doesn't, the insulin takes that sugar and brings it to the cell and says, hey cell, I have some sugar for you, because I know you need the sugar in order to function. That's our energy, it's our main store of energy. Well, after a while, the train keeps bringing sugar into the cell, and the cell starts becoming desensitive to all of that, to the insulin knocking on its door so much, saying more sugar, and it starts to say, no, I don't need any more sugar, and then the sugar starts backing up into the bloodstream. The insulin starts backing up into the bloodstream, and that's what starts causing all the complications with diabetes. Then you get to diabetes. So we start with hypoglycemia. This is typically where sugar imbalance symptoms first start, and these are people, you'll have tiredness, weakness, headache, shakiness, irritability, sleep problems, a lot of sleep problems you can lay on the doorstep of sugar. Insulin resistance. As soon as you start seeing development around the gut, by definition, that's insulin resistance. It's a sugar problem. So this is just little differences between a low blood sugar situation and insulin resistance. So people that have low blood sugar problems, they're going to feel better after a meal. So remember that the sugar went way down, and then you eat some more, so you go, oh, I feel good. But then in too much insulin, it crashes down, and you go, oh, man. And then you eat some more. And these are the people that they need their coffee breaks at 10 o'clock, and they're taking their sweets along the way, causing up and down in blood sugar all day long. Feels better after mood, whereas when you're insulin resistant, you're going to feel tired after a meal. Sugar craving before a meal, sugar cravings after a meal. Insulin resistant, people that need to have sugar after a meal. Sleep disturbances in general are going to be in there. A lot of people who feel tired after a meal, these are the people that eat, and next thing you know, they're crashed out on the couch. That's your insulin resistance showing up. You can see that just has been a significant increase in overweight children. Again, that's been going on since in all nations, led by USA. A lot of the other nations, by the way, are a lot more careful about all of the stuff that they allow into the diet. USA is pretty liberal there. Genetically modified foods to certain chemicals in the foods. We're going to talk a little bit now about the paleo diet, which as a general concept, I think has a lot of value to people with chronic disease. Here we go. So this is the essence of the paleo diet. To start with, we want to you want to knock out all sugar. I don't actually recommend a strict paleo diet to my patients. I recommend a modified one, but definitely no sugar and no fake sugar. Legumes, I think, are okay. These are your beans and such. Grains, I think, if people can remove wheat from their diet or flour from their diet, they would be way ahead of the game. Corn, perhaps. Most all the corn out there, by the way, is genetically modified. Genetically modified brings with it a host of other problems potentially. Okay, so look here at the big triangles. What we see is that what we want to do is we want to have plenty of proteins in the meal, and grass-fed is better, not imperative, but better. Poultry, healthy fish, not farm fish. Farm fish has really got quite a lot of problems with it in terms of chemicals within it because of the feed that they give to the fish. And eggs. If you're going to spend any money at all on something organic, get your eggs to be organic. They're treated a lot more humanely, and the eggs are healthier therefrom. Fats. We're going to talk a little bit about fats that heal and fats that kill, but not all fats are bad. In fact, you want a good chunk of fats in your meal, in your diet. Coconut olive oil is huge. Avocados are wonderful. Grapeseed is also good as an oil. A lot of the other oils are not so good. A lot of vegetables. Berries in the morning is wonderful. Nuts and seeds, very good. Raw is better. Starchy vegetables, this would be like your potatoes, squashes. Okay, brown rice is fine. White rice is fine up in the grain department. I would just get off wheat as a good point over there. Hippocrates, father of medicine, says, let your food be your medicine, and your medicine be your food. How true that is. Too often times, you go to the doctor and you have, I can't sleep, I got depression, I got digestion, I got back pain. And the doctors don't ask you the basic question. The basic question is, what are you eating for breakfast, for lunch, and for dinner?
The diet just does not happen. That's very unfortunate, but it's foundational to functional medicine is working with the diet. Eat a whole food.
Avoid processed and packaged foods. The more processed and packaged foods, the more chemicals in there, the more problems it's going to be for the system. When you shop in a supermarket, shop along the outside of the supermarket where all the good stuff is, not the inside where all the canned foods and packaged foods are. Weapons of mass destruction. So these are things, this really is weapons of mass destruction. You know, things are slanted politically, and of course we have to be concerned about terrorism and all that by all means, but the truth is this is the stuff that kills people day in and day out. And I, for one, am a big fan that if people are getting food stamps, that they should not be allowed weapons of mass destruction. If society is going to support people, then they should not support them to be taking in foods that are later on, in short order, going to be causing society a whole bunch more pills coming their way. Everyone's happy. The pharmaceuticals are happy. The hospitals are happy. Everyone's happy. But society is not happy because we have all these medical bills coming our way because of intake of this. These are very dangerous foods, actually. They really are. Okay, fats that heal and fats that kill. So here we go into the fats that heal. Fish is wonderful, avocado, nuts, flaxseed's excellent. Grinding some flaxseed up in the morning, by the way, is a great way to get a lot of good fiber into your diet, very healthy. A lot of omega oils there as well. And fats that kill. So again, not all fats are bad. There's fats that heal that are very important for your brain. Your brain is like 70% fat. 70% fat. It needs fat. It needs healthy fats. If you take in unhealthy fats, it's going to replace the good fats, and you're going to have problems with cell-to-cell communication and a lot of inflammation going on in your body. Disease will follow. Skippy, unfortunately, has got hydrogenated fats. We all know about hydrogenated fats here. These are vegetable oils that they pump a lot of hydrogen into, so that the vegetable oil, which is normally liquid at room temperature, becomes a solid at room temperature. The classic example of there is margarine. So it used to be, oh yeah, I have margarine because it's better than butter. Not true. So let's look at this over here. It is a misconception that orange juice and such is a healthy food. In point of fact, the amount of sugar that is inside a glass of orange juice is not too dissimilar from the amount of sugar that's in a glass of Coca-Cola.
I have a question. What about if it's juiced orange juice and not bottled stuff?
No, but vegetable juices would be okay.
Okay.
Even carrot juice is potentially an issue over there.
I juice a lot.
Yeah, but all the greens are wonderful. A little bit of carrot juice thrown in there is fine.
Okay.
And so here's some examples of some healthier alternatives for breakfast. Eggs are wonderful. Oatmeal is good. Fish in the morning is fine. Again, you want to cut back on the amount of wheat flour. Now we're going to go into the item number two of the five steps that I want to talk about. Digestive system. We talked a little bit about good and bad microbes, which brings us to leaky gut. So what happens is that if you take in items that you are sensitive to, if you take in chemicals that you are sensitive to, if you have a polluted environment, a congested environment internally, you are going to start compromising gut function. You are going to start inviting in microbes that are not healthy to, and you're going to lay out the red carpet for them, and they are going to feel invited inside your gut. and they're going to hang out and they're going to populate and they're going to have a lot of kids and they're going to have more bad microbes, and all these bad microbes start causing inflammation. And as they cause inflammation, they literally send out chemicals, and those chemicals will start getting into the bloodstream. So normally you should have a very tight gut barrier so that things don't get from the gut into the bloodstream, because once it's in the bloodstream, the body's got to go into reaction and deal with various items that are in there that are problematic to the system. So the gut's got a very strong barrier to keep things moving along and out, but if you have a leaky gut, then things start leaking in that wouldn't otherwise. And the reason it starts leaking is because a lot of bad microbes are over there, because foods are taken in that start causing inflammation and irritation to the system. I was at a seminar about 2 months ago now by a wonderful medical, in fact, he was on Dr. Oz's show. He was one of the doctors, of five doctors that Dr. Oz said these are wonderful representations of functional medicine. He's a neurologist, practices in Florida, Dr. Perlmutter, David Perlmutter, and he said at this lecture he didn't recognize that as a neurologist, he'd actually be practicing gastroenterology. You have to fix the gut if you're going to be, if you're going to work on the brain. So when you have a leaky gut, there's also something called the blood-brain barrier. Things don't get into the brain. That's why certain chemicals, certain drugs are very problematic to work on brain tumors, for example, because they don't pierce into the blood-brain barrier. But when you have a leaky gut, you end up with a leaky brain as well, inflammation up there, and things start getting into the brain, and that's how you can start having mood situations, for example, among other things. Okay. Oh, I want to talk about one other thing on leaky gut. There's another doctor out there in England whose child had autism. Her name is Dr. Natasha Campbell. And so she took the child to the regular medical route, and she's a neurologist herself, and the child would not respond to regular medical care. Then she started looking at a functional medical model, a holistic model, and worked with the diet, worked with fixing the gut, and the child did get better. You can see an interview, about a 1 hour interview of her thoughts and philosophy on this whole thing at mercola.com, mercola.com, and you can look up the Dr. Campbell interview. But the essence of what she says is that because people have been taking a lot more antibiotics since World War II, the antibodies disrupt the internal environment. And that, again, I forgot to mention that 90% of the cells in our body are actually microbes. 90% are microbes. Are microbes. And so those microbes, we want them to be healthy, not unhealthy. So she recommends things like fermented foods and healthy foods to repair the internal gut area, and then things can start healing up. Food allergies. The most common food allergies out there, wheat and dairy are the big ones, actually. Eggs is also potentially common. There's different ways of finding out what they are. But the thing about them, though, is that they're sneaky. They're not the kind that send you to the emergency room that are very evident. They're actually the kind that cause joint pain, that cause insomnia, mood disorders, and they don't present themselves for 2-3 days after you eat it, and so you don't associate the two necessarily. This is a very important quote by Dr. James Brennan, MD. I believe from my clinical experience that 60% of undiagnosed symptoms in general family practice have food allergy or food reactivity as a significant part of their pathogenesis. I always, always find food allergies when I'm dealing with chronic patients. I always find an imbalance in healthy and bad microbes in chronic patients. These are some of the symptoms that come from food allergies: fatigue, depression, gallbladder problems, certainly, insomnia, obesity. Chemical toxins that are out there, heavy metals, pesticides and such, and another class of chemicals called endocrine disruptors that will cause problems to your hormonal system. If your liver is working well, it will detoxify these chemicals and they won't have a bad impact on your physiology. If your liver is congested, then it will. By the way, Tylenol has a harsh impact on the liver, as does, of course, too much alcohol. A glass of alcohol for women, 2 glasses for men is fine. More than that is a problem. Classic study on chemical toxicity, it is quite interesting. When you have 1 chemical on an animal, no problem. 2 chemicals, you end up with a decline in health. 3 chemicals added into the mixture, the rats died within 2 weeks. Hormones. When you balance all the things that I talked about, the blood sugar, the food allergies, the digestion, the good and bad microbes, You get the liver working well. Then you work with thyroid, adrenal, sex hormones. But many doctors will just jump right on the sex hormones, for example, or on the thyroid. And the people are taking thyroid, for example, and they go to the doctor and they say, you know, the doctor says my thyroid numbers are good, but why do I still have this mood disorder? Why can't I sleep? Why am I not losing weight? And the answer is because they haven't dealt with those other four factors that we just talked about earlier. You can't just jump on hormones and say that's the magic answer. It's a strong area, but it's not the full answer. Some of the things that respond well to this approach, some of the different conditions. Obesity, certainly. This is interesting. National Weight Control Registry over at Brown Medical School. 10,000 people who have lost a minimum of 30 pounds for 1 year minimum, average have lost 70 pounds for 6 years. This is what they have in common. First of all, they found that all diets work, so it's not really critical. Just find one that works for you and go with that. Bottom line is decrease calories and increase exercise. 90% of long-term successful weight loss are exercising. On average, people that are in this registry exercise approximately 1 hour per day, 7 days per week. They got on a scale every day. They eat breakfast regularly. Most watch less than half the amount of TV as your overall population. Average person out there in the population is watching more than five hours per day of TV. They get into a same pattern of foods. They don't vary their diet too much. They know what foods work for them and they stick with that. They eat less than most people by 50 to 300 calories per day. Remember before we talked about all the increase in sugar going on these days? That adds 88 calories per day to the diet. So if you got rid of refined sugar in your diet, you'd save 88 calories a day. You'd be doing weight loss. No sugar, no white flour. Drink water. Overeaters Anonymous and Food Addicts Anonymous. By the way, Food Addicts Anonymous, my patients tell me that one works better for them typically. And what they do is they give you a diet, whereas Overeaters Anonymous does not. The diet that they give you is no sugar, no flour. That's where they start with. This is an interesting study that was published recently in Journal of American Medical Association 2011, and it shows that for every increase of 2 hours of daytime viewing of TV, you get a 20% increase in diabetes, 15% increase in cardiovascular disease, 13% of all-cause mortality. There was a recent study that was published about 2 weeks ago that talked about people that take in too much red meat, about a 13% mortality if you're taking in red meat every day. The suggestion was that you should take red meat in no more than once per week. And I think that's a good recommendation. If you had fish, you decrease your mortality rate. Chicken is fine, but pork and red meat are no-go items. Exercise for 20 minutes a day. That is a good recommendation. Which exercise do you do? You do the exercise that you like. So if it's walking, if it's hiking, if it's tennis, if it's whatever, it doesn't matter. If you're not in a exercising mode, the recommendation is put your gym shorts on the sofa and just have it look at you, and then eventually put them on, and then eventually get out there and do a 5 minute walk and increase the 5 minute walk to a 10 minute walk. But start with a small step. Don't say I have to do an hour a day. You don't. If you do 20 minutes a day, you're gonna catch most of the benefits of exercise. If you can do it every day, wonderful. If you do it 3-4 days a week, you're in there. You're about 80% good. So start little and then build up to it. And whatever it is that you like to do is what you should be doing. And finally, get adequate rest and sleep. This is not appreciated enough, but if you're not getting a good night's sleep, all kinds of things start going wrong. There's just a recent study, by the way, that talked about sleep medications and how disruptive they are to good health. So if you're not sleeping well, sometimes medications are cool if you're taking them short term. When you take them long term, that's where the problems come in. And that's the problem, is that they're so enticing because they kind of give you that quick fix. But then you got to pay the price because now you're hooked. So getting adequate sleep is real, real important for so many reasons. That's when your body does the healing, is at nighttime. Okay. That concludes the talk. I thank you very much for coming. Yes. It's the proteins within the wheat that the body is reacting to, and that's the problem. Sprouted wheat perhaps is a little less allergenic like that. But for a lot of people, wheat is a real problem. People with Hashimoto's thyroiditis, by the way, it's pretty bad there. A lot of neurologic disorders are aggravated with wheat. It's interesting that that Food Addicts Anonymous talks about sugar, which is easy to pick on, but they also latched onto wheat as a main problem there for a lot of people, flour. No. The more you get rid of it and fake sugars, the better. If you need a fake sugar, use stevia. It tends to be the most gentle on the system. Stevia. Stevia. It's an herb.
Yeah. How about the
galbanectin? Yeah, it's overstated. It's yeah.
What's
overstated? Guava nectar and some of these other yeah. It's refined sugar and you're getting strong doses of sugars in. Perhaps it has some, yeah, it's not a bad way to go, but you start doing too much of it, it's a problem. So, you know, a little bit perhaps, but it's a problem. And the more you have a problem, the more you just want to remove it all. If you don't have a problem, you can get away with it. About 40% of the population is really sensitive to sugar.
And so if there's no wheat and flour to make a sandwich for your kids, what do you make a sandwich for?
You avoid that. There are some gluten-free breads that are out there that are not bad. There's some excellent gluten-free, just look for gluten-free, but there's some very good pasta that's gluten-free, and there's some breads that are gluten-free, and otherwise just give them a plastic bag and use that.
Or bag. My question is about alcohol, because you had mentioned it, and a few weeks ago I was debating with my friends about alcohol being bad for your liver, and they were trying to tell me that they read a study that alcohol why
it may be true. Doctors are typically hesitant to recommend alcohol because people think that if one is good, two is also okay, and maybe three is okay, and actually maybe seven or eight is even okay also, and so it's a real problem. But the reality is, for a male, you get two drinks a day, and that is okay and even beneficial. And a woman is half that amount. There's lots of good evidence out there that red wine is excellent for your health. But even straight alcohol is potentially A-okay and maybe even somewhat beneficial. Yeah, we just have to be cautious about that. Okay, good.
Thank you.
Thank you.